Good morning, good morning. Thank you so much for joining me. This is the lovely podcast, The Endurance of Labor Laws. I am your lovely host, Leslie Sullivan, and this is episode 22 of this podcast. So we're moving right along. I think this is absolutely great. And today we are going to take a look at the International Union of Operating Engineers. This one is very interesting because when I researched it, there's not a lot of history listed out there regarding this one, which I found kind of odd, but I even checked out their website, and there's really not much there discussing its specific history. Like, we know the definitive founding date, but it doesn't tell me who specifically, like individual and person-wise, who founded it, and the who, what, when, where, how, why kind of behind it. But first and foremost, I want to give a shout-out to my listeners. This is wonderful. I love you guys, my subscribers. I first want to mention Texas, Oklahoma, Virginia, New York, and the Netherlands has been listening in. So thank you so much. I have never been to the Netherlands, but I would love to come see you guys sometime. I think it's a wonderful country, so that's absolutely great. Thank you so much for listening in. I would like to give a shout out to Stitcher, which is a platform that is helping me with my podcast. That is absolutely wonderful. I would love to give a shout out to my internet provider, which is Cox Cable. They have been absolutely wonderful with my internet. They have just been phenomenal helping me with this, just really good internet connection, making sure that everything is loading in terms of being able to use high-speed internet, if I could say that correctly there. So that is really good as well. And also I wanted to give a shout out to any and all that have encouraged me to do this podcast. There was actually a young woman that I met many years ago in my 20s. I was looking for an apartment, and President Obama was president at the time, and we were just talking, you know, just about everyday life and, you know, what's going on in our country. And she said, you need to be on YouTube. You need to do media. You need to get out there. You're really good. You have a great voice. You know, just go do it. And unfortunately, I did not follow through on that way back then. For whatever reason, I was working, and I wasn't really sure whether or not to do that. But I have been in media and the entertainment industry off and on. Let's see, it goes back to when I started doing voiceovers when I was probably 16 or 17, maybe when I was 18, because I started doing voiceovers before I graduated high school and then went to college. And Oklahoma is not known for its media, per se, in terms of entertainment industry, but we're slowly getting there. But needless to say, people from all over the world have used my voice and have asked me to help them out with different things. And I've also worked as a model a little bit here and there locally in Oklahoma City. So I've done that as well. I've done some artwork. So I've done quite a few different things besides being in the accounting world. It's kind of one of those things I would always fall back on accounting because that work is always there. So for example, if a contract fell through on modeling, yes, it disappointed me, but I knew that I could always go into accounting to make up for that lost income. And so that way I make sure I have access to food, water, and shelter, and that, you know, I'm going to be able to pay my bills. So that's really good there. And so another thing I want to let you know is that we have launched a YouTube channel, which is absolutely wonderful. So do feel free to check out my YouTube channel. It is The Endurance of Labor Laws. You can look it up by that title, or you can look it up under me, under Leslie Sullivan. So that is L-E-S-L-E-Y. Last name Sullivan, S-U-L-L-I-V-A-N. Do subscribe. It's a wonderful thing. And the videos are going up there. And what we're doing, what my team is doing, is they are taking all these podcasts and they're putting it to kind of a digital format. It's going to look like the same picture that you've seen on the podcast websites if you're looking from the website. But they're just putting my voice out there, and it is the exact same episodes. But what we're going to do going forward, we're going to switch over to doing actual videos. And so that way the video we will post on YouTube, but the audio we will go ahead and post to our podcast platforms like we are right now. But that way with these videos going forward, once we get that launched and set up, you will be able to see me because I am a real person and so are you. So I think it's great to see who you are speaking to or who you're listening to. I think that's wonderful. So that is a good thing. So we are in the works on that. And I just wanted to give a shout out to my marketing team as well, to the people that have been working behind the scenes, also in basically the gurus of technology that have been helping me do all this stuff with my podcast. And this podcast has just grown. It is just tremendous. I am so happy. I'm so excited about it. I'm so glad I took that leap of faith and went ahead and started this podcast because it's been on my heart and on my soul and my mind for a long time. I just wasn't always exactly sure what topic to talk about. And then, you know, because I'm a woman of prayer, so when I prayed about it, I was like, you know what, the workplace and our labor laws and our constitution in the United States is really important to me. So I thought, you know, that's probably a great place to start as well. But just so you know, our first episode launched November 4th of this year. And since then, we have done 22 episodes. This is the 22nd one. And we have been reaching people all over the globe. I'm just amazed at the abundance of listeners and just how well this podcast is going. I was not expecting it to just skyrocket like that. I thought this was just going to stay more local. To be honest, I really thought it was just something that I'm doing part-time, but it is becoming a full-time job, which is awesome because when you're doing something that you love, it by far does not feel like a job. It's just something that you love to do. It comes easy, which is awesome. I love that. So, but what's interesting is that this podcast started out local within Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. Then it went statewide. And then it went national. It went to other states within the United States. And then it went international. And now we are being heard in other countries, other continents. And I am just amazed at that. I never thought that it would do this, but I'm so grateful. I'm just taken aback by it. There are just so many words I wish I could say, but it's just one of those things I'm kind of speechless in that respect, but in a good way. So thanks again to anyone and everyone that has been listening, and thank you so much for just being there for me. I greatly appreciate that. I'm glad that we can walk together on this journey and learn something new about the United States, about our labor laws, about our unions, and you know, just have fun with it, you know, and just really go for it because knowledge is power. So I say let's go ahead and get started. And so let's go ahead and get going here. So this one is kind of a short and sweet union, and I'm actually setting a timer for 20 minutes because when I first recorded this, it went over an hour. But that's because sometimes I go off on tangents. It's like, you know what, I'm going to limit it to 20 minutes. And if we go a little bit over, then it's a little bit over, but I don't want to do the sidewinder on this. But if I do need to follow up on anything, I will make another episode and just put follow up to whatever the case may be. So let's go ahead and get started on this one. This one is the International Union of Operating Engineers. It was founded December 7th, 1896. It is headquartered in Washington, D.C. They have locations in the United States and Canada. They have a little over 374,000 members. At this point, they're saying that they have roughly 400,000 members and 170 local unions, and they operate nearly 100 apprenticeship programs. Their current president is James T. Callahan. They have affiliations with the AFL-CIO, the CLC, NAMTU. And what I find interesting about this union is that, you know, when I'm researching it, it doesn't list all their presidents like the other unions I've researched. It lists none of them. It just lists the current one, which I find kind of odd. So that's a little weird. It also doesn't tell me who specifically founded it, like who, what, when, where, how, why, just those basic foundational facts. It's not listed here. I don't know why. I find that kind of odd, especially since it has so many members. I checked out their website as well. It's very vague. I mean, it looks like a nice website, but in terms of what we're looking at, you know, the specifics, the statistics, the basics, the foundation of their organization, it's very vague, and I find that kind of fishy. It also doesn't tell me if they have donated any monies to any particular political party, excuse me, and because I always like to know who are they donating stuff to, because that tells a lot about the organization and how they operate. But it says here that the International Union of Operating Engineers is a trade union within the United States, and it is primarily representing construction workers who work as heavy equipment operators, mechanics, surveyors, and stationary engineers, also called operating engineers or power engineers, who maintain heating and other systems in buildings and industrial complexes in the United States and Canada. What I get concerned about, as usual, is whenever you have a union that is operating or has a location in another country. Because again, Canada's labor laws are nothing like ours. our laws are nothing like their laws. And so we need to be careful who we are aligning ourselves with, because Canada is not known for being a prosperous country. Nothing against you, Canada. I love you. I have visited your country. It's great. But in terms of this podcast and what we're looking at, Canada is not really known for being a gold mine, I guess you could say. I don't know how else to describe it. Like, when people are talking about immigrating to a new beginning and wanting a better future, people always talk about the United States. They don't talk about Canada. So then moving on, it lists all these different locals. So all these different locals within this union, but they're very odd. This is the first time I've ever researched this, and they list all these different locals, but they don't really tell you much about them. It's kind of weird. And then this tells us a little bit about their training facilities. I'm not real concerned with that. That doesn't really matter, because I really want the historical value. The most historical value I have found is where it says on April 10th, 2019, President Trump visited the IUOE Training and Education Center and issued two executive orders to change the process for how pipeline projects were approved, which aimed to simplify the process for oil and gas companies in the United States. I think that's wonderful. I know some people don't like Trump, but here's the thing. He did a lot of things that were for good for our country that we don't know about. And this is really a true testament to how he works. You know, I know some people didn't like him because he's from New York. He's a New Yorker. He can be loud, bombastic. But here's the thing. That's just the New Yorker in him. That's just where he was raised. Number two, he's a very successful businessman. And what I think is awesome about Trump, this is his natural skill set, is he can walk in to any type of environment, any type of business association, any type of company. He can assess the situation, and he can come up with an idea immediately on how to help make things more manageable, run it better, and for things to be run more efficiently. That is his natural skill set, and that's why he is very talented in business. That's why he is so successful. So that's one of the great things I wish more people would realize about President Trump, is that, you know, he was a very successful businessman for, gosh, 40 years or something before he became president of the United States. And I think that's a true testament to how he understands how businesses run, and that he can definitely help our government run better and be more efficient in terms of budgeting, and, you know, help companies be able to have pipelines and things like that, because we do need pipelines. I know we have some environmentalists listening, but the point is, all types of energy are good energy. All types of resources are good resources. So I say that we should use them and use them responsibly. And when you streamline something and make it more efficient, then you're actually being kinder and better to the environment, because you know you're going to need natural resources anyway, so you might as well use them for good. So this one, there's an article in here that talks about a temporary foreign worker legal challenge. So I'm going to go ahead and read this. It says, in 2013, IUOE Local 115, along with the BC Building Trades Union, had tried to overcome permits given to Murray River Coal Mine near Tumbler Ridge, British Columbia, to hire 201 Chinese temporary workers to work on a new mine owned by Chinese nationals. The unions claimed that the job ads were written to exclude Canadian workers and instead chose to hire Chinese workers for lower wages rather than source or train local miners from the immediate area or the province. However, a federal court judge disagreed. Russell Zinn found that HD Mining, the owner of the coal mine, had fulfilled the requirements set out in a federally mandated labor market opinion, also known as a LMO, and dismissed the union's challenge, which I find very interesting that a judge would make a decision like this. I'm really surprised by this, especially because it's in Canada and you're dealing with a labor union. And I do think this company was wrong. It says, however, public and media attention on the case resulted in some changes being implemented into the Canadian Temporary Foreign Worker Program to ensure that foreign workers are not chosen over local resources where available. Okay, so what I want to talk about this a little bit here is that whenever you have, how do I word this? You have Chinese nationals trying to operate a business in a different country. So they obviously are not going to want to utilize your labor. Because what you need to remember about the Chinese is that they're communists. And communists, they have slave labor over there in China. We know this. People don't want to acknowledge it, but they do. And so that's what these Chinese temporary workers were and probably still are. So what you have to realize is that these Chinese business owners, they specifically did not want to hire local workers because they did not want to have to pay them the appropriate wages and they did not want to deal with unions. Now, I look at it from both sides here. If you're a company that's operating from another country, you want to do this. You want to do your business quickly and efficiently, and you really don't want to have to pay more than you have to. I get that. And more than likely, you don't want to have to deal with a labor union. On the other side of that coin, I agree with the Canadians here that, I mean, I didn't read the ad, but I would want more local workers to do the work as opposed to bringing in slave labor from China and their communist people. Because what people don't know about China is that the reason why they have slave labor is how they set up their school system. And I know this because I dated a guy from China many years ago. He was probably like 10 or 15 years older than me, but we were talking about how we each went to college. And, you know, I was asking him, hey, how did you come to the United States? How did you get into school? Like, I know nothing about that because his journey was completely separate or different than mine because I was just more along the lines of the girl next door, per se, and his is coming from a different country. So the way it works in China is if your parents, first of all, at that time, it was a one-child law back then. So his parents had to fork over a lot of money for his sister to be born because if you don't have the money to pay for a second child to be born, then the communist police department, I guess you could say, they basically force these women to have abortions and they sterilize them right there on the table while they're having the abortion. So basically his family did have money. They were not super wealthy, but they had enough money that they could pay for his sister to be born. And then when you're going to school, we're talking about in public school system here in communist China. So basically you get to go to school, but it's not the same way as here in the United States. He told me that, you know, if you want to go all the way to college, you can, that's your choice. But in China, you don't have that choice. You have to pass all these exams. And if you don't pass an exam to go to the next level, then you are forever stuck at the educational level and you don't get to go on to the next level. I was like, what do you mean? And so what he told me was that over in China, because their school systems are controlled by the communist government and they want to control people's lives, they control the labor, they have a lot of people, let me get a drink of water. They have a lot of people that are slave labor, and the way they control them is this way. Excuse me for a minute. So what happens is, so he goes to school. He goes to a public school that's managed by the communist government, which is the most common school there. It's like our public schools here. It's run by the government. You have a department that manages it, but it's way worse over there, way more controlling and way more vicious in terms of control. So I think it's around fourth or fifth grade, you have to take a test, the kid does, in order to get into middle school. If you don't pass that test to get into middle school, you are forever stuck at a fourth or fifth grade level education, and you are not allowed to move up in the social status or social structure of the Chinese society. And so then you will always have that kind of job that meets the fourth or fifth grade criteria. So let's say, for example, you might be a rice farmer, you might be a nail technician or a construction worker, whatever the case may be, but you are never, ever allowed to move up because you failed that test, and you're only allowed to take it once. So he passed, he got into middle school, and as you go further into the school system, you move higher up, it gets way more and more competitive. You know, Asians, they're not necessarily smarter than Europeans or the Irish or the English or Americans, whatever the case may be. The reason why they do better in school is because most of them had to study really hard from the moment they could read and the moment they could learn something, because it is literally that intense in the Asian culture, especially in China. I don't know about Japan, but in China, it was very much like this. So he got into middle school. Then the rush is on, the test is on, the pressure is on to pass the test to get into high school. If you don't pass that test to get into high school, then you are forever stuck at a middle school education. So the highest level of a job you could get is something that someone in middle school would do, which is like, I don't know, 12, 13, 14 years old, whatever their skill set is, that's where you stay at for your entire life. Then, let's say you get into high school like this guy did, then the pressure is on to get into college. So not only do they have public schools over there, they have private schools, but he wanted to come to the United States and go to our universities. And the reason why is because these international students, they want to work in the United States. And they know that if they get an American degree, get a degree from an American college, they will have a way easier job of getting a job in the private sector if they graduate from an American university as opposed to a university in China. That doesn't mean that these universities in China are not accredited, because they are. It's just easier to get a job in the United States if you have gone to college in the United States and you're already accustomed to the American way of life and you're already being introduced to these people, and plus you have that degree to back you, so to speak. So as we've talked about in previous podcasts, it's very difficult for international students to come here to the United States because, first of all, their education is going to cost way more. What might cost you and me $4,000 a semester would easily cost an international student $14,000 a semester, and that is at a public state university in Oklahoma. So I can only imagine what Harvard and Yale and some of these other schools charge. It's insane. These higher education places, which prefer to colleges, these higher education facilities that are universities, they make bank. They can claim they're nonprofit. They are not nonprofit. They are totally for profit. They totally rip these international students a new one. They put them through the ringer in terms of applications. And also, they have them submit bank statements proving they have all these monies in their bank account, whether it is their personal bank account or whether it is their parents' financial bank account. And they have to submit financial statements and financial records proving all this. So these higher education places, they're claiming to be inclusive and that they care about people. They really don't. They're in it for the money. So just because someone says they're a nonprofit organization, I don't believe that, because in order to stay in business, you have to be for profit. Unfortunately, with the higher education system, they make so much money, it's unbelievable. So not only are they making money off of, in-state tuition, out-of-state tuition, but also international tuition. Excuse me. But also, they're getting federal grants, Pell Grants and stuff like that from the federal government, which are our tax dollars. So these universities are not broke. They can claim they are not. So they don't really even need to do fundraisers because they're just using us, the taxpayers, as a slush fund. Let me get a drink of water here real quick. The air is kind of dry here right now in Oklahoma because it's like the weather gets really cold, then it gets back up to 70. So then we go from being super dry air to being humid, so it kind of affects your allergies and your voice. So, but anyway, so this guy I dated, he told me all this stuff about China and how difficult it is to go to school in China. And also another thing is that the way that they also control their labor is, let's say, for example, you go to high school, but you fail that test to go into college. Well, then the Chinese government, the educators there, they fool their people into thinking that their high school education is actually a college degree because they want them to feel more important about themselves than what they actually have, because they don't want them to wake up to the fact that, hey, you only have a high school education. You don't have a college degree. And some of these people found this out by applying to jobs that require a college degree. But yet when they went through the process of trying to apply for these jobs, they were finally told, hey, you don't have a college degree. You only went to high school. So then these students that were applying said, what? No, this is a college degree. And these employers told them, no, it's not a college degree. It's only high school. So with that being in mind, I'm not surprised at all that these Chinese nationals, and when you hear Chinese nationals, you need to think of super rich, wealthy people from China that don't care about human life. And I mean that literally, because when you have super wealthy people over in China like this, they don't even value their own people because they're willing to use their own people as slave labor in another country, but not even really give them freedom. An example of this is in a previous podcast where I mentioned that I know some people that they went to the Bahamas for a vacation, and there was this Chinese company building a resort there on the island that they were staying at. And it was a compound. They had the chain link fence up, they had the barbed wire, and they had basically Chinese slave labor building this resort. And these people were not, these slaves were not allowed to leave the compound. I mean, eventually the deal fell through. But what I want to bring a point here is that, you know, the government in the Bahamas, they authorized this. You can't tell me they didn't know China was going to behave like this. It's the same thing with Canada. Whenever you see companies like this that are coming into your country and they're doing business like this, yes, the company is bad. Yes, these Chinese nationals are not really good people because they obviously do not value human life if they're okay with importing slave labor from their home country. But also, the Canadian government allowed this because in order for this type of work to happen, this company had to apply for work permits to get this done. So it was authorized by some Canadian bureaucrat that was okay with Chinese nationals coming into Canada, operating there, having a company there, and then also authorized them to bring in so-called temporary Chinese workers, also known as communist slave labor. So, you know, Canada, the government there, all these different bureaucrats that are in charge, and again, bureaucrat is a professional paper pusher. These people are not known for being moral or having values. They're not really interested in looking out for anyone except themselves, per se. And so what you have to remember is that when you're dealing with government officials like this, they don't have your back. They only have their own back, and they're in it for the money. So I guarantee you the Canadian government was looking at this as an opportunity to make a lot of money real quick, like a short sale. But unfortunately, the locals, the Canadian people in this area, the Canadian citizens realized what was happening. They threw a hissy fit, and a good thing they did, called these people out on this. And then hence, there were some changes that were made to the Canadian Temporary Foreign Worker Program. I'm glad that happened because, you know, you can get mad at companies and at individual people all day. But if you don't call your government out on this stuff, then you're totally missing it. Because if you don't bring change to a broken program or a broken system, then it's going to continue to remain broken and not be a good fit for you, your society, and your country. So it's a good thing the Temporary Foreign Worker Program was changed or modified and made it so that it preferred Canadians over foreign labor. You know, we have some of that same problem here in the United States because there are a lot of people that are without work because of foreign labor coming in, whether it's illegal or legal. You know, because there are some people, they have such a horrible opinion of Americans. They're like, oh, you're lazy, you don't have a job. Well, why do they not have a job? You know, it used to be easy to go out and find a job. You know, like when young people, you know, they're in college and they just want to work during the summer or something, it used to be easy to go out and find, you know, a job working on a farm or a factory or things like that, something simple. But because there are employers okay with illegal workers, and also if they are not okay with illegal workers, then they're making it legal by going through a foreign worker program, which I think is like the H-1 or B-1 worker permit or something. I'll have to look that up. I used to know all that because I researched it back when President Obama was president, because we were having problems with foreign workers here in Oklahoma. So we were trying to figure out what kind of permits are they supposed to have to legally be here. Because in the United States, we are for people. We are for helping people, but you need to do things by our laws. You know, we're not okay with people breaking the law. And if you're here illegally, you are breaking the law, unfortunately. So you need to start obeying the law. And if you're working for an employer that is recruiting you here and it's against the law, then don't do that kind of work. You know, it's kind of the same thing here with the Chinese. But you have to remember that, you know, you can have a horrible negative opinion of really rich people. But here's the thing. Our rich people are way nicer than rich people in other countries, especially in China. Because when you're dealing with rich people from China, they are very controlling. Some of them are very evil communists. Because in order to get to the top, some heads had to roll, because that's how the Communist Party is. Because when you have communism, you don't have freedom. And we can see that here with these Chinese workers that were considered temporary. They're not temporary. They're permanently stuck in a type of slavery in their country, and they just get, you know, moved around from country to country for labor, but it's not a good job. So just recognize that even though you can be irritated at a company or a CEO or something like that at a local or federal level, but you have to really look at, you know, what is your government doing? What laws and bylaws do they have in place, and what are they not honoring to protect your local citizens? Because that's what was happening here, big time. So we're going a little over 20 minutes, so I guess we'll go ahead and finish up. It really just talks about the different locals, and this is kind of odd because it just lists like local 902, local 904, but it doesn't really give very much data at all. So this union is a little weird. Like, I literally don't have much information about this except what I just told you and about some stuff that was happening there. But and it doesn't even really talk about anything that was happening in the United States in regards to their labor. They talk about a couple training facilities, but that doesn't really tell me anything. I mean, I just think it's kind of odd. But, you know, that is what it is. But I guess we'll go ahead and end this podcast with that, kind of short and sweet and to the point. But do check out my YouTube channel and do subscribe, because we are loading more and more videos there every day. Really good content. It's really good because knowledge is power. And as usual, I pray that you're happy, healthy, and whole in everything that you do. And if you have any questions or concerns, or if you want a shout out, feel free to contact me anytime at yourlaborlaws@gmail.com. Again, that's yourlaborlaws@gmail.com. So until next time, just have a wonderful week. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Thank you.